Okay, welcome all. Great to see you back here. My name is Joost Lommers. I'm a managing consultant from a company in the Netherlands, Trivento Spark. And we are enterprise designers, we think at least. But my history is, my experience is more in enterprise architecture. So I'm also an enterprise architect. And I'm going to do something, a disclaimer at front, I'm going to do something that Sasha was told not to do, and that is show some really ugly diagrams to you as part of the presentation. But let's see what happens. Okay, setting the stage, this is me. And I basically have 28 years of experience. I'm an engineer. I was educated in computer science, and I'm now for 20 years, I'm an architect. But one of the things that always, surprised me, that I've in my early days, I've worked on a lot of systems that, that were built to spec, but no one was loving them, no one was liking them. I've built a lot of software that everybody hates. And so basically, some of my colleagues thought, well, that's the way the world is. Basically, I thought, well, wait a minute, there's something happening. And so I gained interest in a thing called usability. Wait a minute, a system needs to be usable, and a system needs to be attractive, so people are going to use it, and the system, the software, is successful. Well, that's my that was always a hobby of mine, because as an architect, you don't have to think about that, of course. Hey? You just draw boxes and lines, and you figure out something, and then people build it. But in 2012, I think we saw the book by Milan, and that connected some stuff that I thought was really important. Not only doing some engineering about software systems, but also connected them to usability and even to branding. Because nowadays, well, if you are a company and you want to service your customers, there's always a digital part in that process. There's always a digital part in that service. And I was really intrigued. So we started doing that as a company also. But I'm still an enterprise architect, and I'm also a member of of the program committee of a Dutch annual conference on that. And it's a combination. I like it. I'm part of Trivento Spark. We are a very small organization. And many of my colleagues are still just building software, trying to make great software, trying to make people happy with software. And me and my colleagues are more at the front at designing stuff. And we are also, based on the book and based on talks with Milan, and we are also organizing meetups in the Netherlands to get enterprise design known in my country. Because we thought, well, this is very interesting, a very interesting framework, very interesting book and method, and we are trying to get people enthusiastic about it. So since November 1st last year, we have had four meetups to get people interested, and some of those people are here now, and I'm really glad that it's working out. Okay, I say what, I'm an enterprise architect basically, so what is enterprise architecture? Anyone has an image of that, does know what it is? Everyone is scared now. Okay, first ugly diagram. Yeah, basically this is what you see most if you think about enterprise architecture. There's a lot of boxes. They all have tiny print in them. This one is blurred on purpose because we don't want to show you what it's really about. No, but You can also see these kind of diagrams. This is kind of a landscape, pointing out which areas there are, functional areas, applications. It can be all parts of organizations with a bit of data flow of interconnections. This is more a layered model. Architects like layered models. And we're doing a lot of interesting stuff. But basically, it's the word architecture is maybe a bit wrong, because architecture in building houses, architecture is about what the house looks like, while enterprise architecture is more about city planning. So you see a few like this. This is where I live. And the funny part is this area of my city was really, really designed. And the city planner drew this as a set of ideas with concepts like there is a hidden zone, and there is some water, and we have to protect that water from the city. Basically, these have become houses. And also, there is a circle in the middle, which became a street. And this circle is exactly as big as the old city center of my, the medieval city center of my city. So there are all kinds of, well, visions, ideas, which are here put out and then into a city plan. And basically, someone put houses in it. And city planning is not only about the streets, but also about the facilities. Where do we put the houses where people live? Where do we put the shops? Where do we put industry? Where do we put schools? Where do we put green and playgrounds? And all those things compete. Because, for instance, I live very near the shopping center. And I like that very much, because it's easy to go to the supermarket. But at the same time, through my street, all the trucks go that bring goods, bring stuff to that shopping mall. And I don't like that. It's a bit noisy. But city planning is about, well, trying to make things work. And it's also about a big vision, because the man who drew this and basically made the plan, well, he wasn't involved in all the tiny little details that we had and problems that we had when we actually built those houses and put those shops in. And for instance, the crossing in my street was very dangerous, and it has been rebuilt four times in the last 20 years, and accidents keep happening. Well, it's a design flaw. But so enterprise architecture is more like city planning. And we still make all those ugly diagrams. But the fun part was, last month, I found this picture on the internet, on LinkedIn. And this is Rabobank. It's a big bank in the Netherlands. And there the architects have built a prototype of their architecture. And basically with all the systems and even the server parks below. And on the top, there are the offices that use the software and the services and the hardware below. And this is where traditional building architecture and digital architecture, they connect again. Now we're also building true 3D prototypes. Okay, the boring stuff is that what we do finally gets down in architecture principles guidelines. We also talk about non-functional properties. That's a common term, non-functional properties. It's about performance, responsiveness, scalability, privacy, security. All those things that you think, well, that a system needs to do too. So you want to make an order, you want to make a payment in your app, and it should be easy. You should be engaged, it should be really nice to do. But in fact, you also like it to be safe. Only we're not talking about that much, but still, as an architect, we worry about that. And I'm always worried. Yeah. Also because most of it, what you see is that it is about managing compromises and disillusions. No, you can't do that. And what it also is, and that's the funny part, because here we are entering in the enterprise design realm. We are talking about innovations, about doing stuff better, about giving better experiences to our customers, to our clients, to our users. But if you look at it from an architecture point, then you also see, well, it's a lot about fighting technical debt and legacy, because all those innovations that we want to roll out, still, there's a lot of stuff in that organization that we maybe need to decommission or that needs to be reused. So basically, technical debt, quick and dirty solutions that will haunt us in the future, probably sometimes forever, and legacy, a business or system that resists change. And the funny part is if you really dive into the trenches of the organization, then you find that a lot. Not only in IT systems, because there's it's a word that's really known, but also in business models or even in culture. People working in a certain way, thinking that they are still need to do the stuff they did 10 years ago, but in fact the organization changed, the goals changed, and you want the culture change, but that one didn't happen. So a lot of people are a bit of they're unhappy in their current position, because they think that they are not allowed to do what they like anymore. Well, there was always a way of fighting that, and well, this is also the mandatory Steve Jobs picture. I learned that from designers. And but basically, what Steve Jobs did is Apple was creating the Lisa computer, and he thought about it. It should be different. It should be a different computer. It should be easier. It should also be cheaper. The Lisa was planned to be quite expensive. And finally, what he did was, okay, I have a small team. I give them the mission to create this computer platform, and eventually he even moved them out of the building. He set them apart and said, create this computer for me. The computer was created, and they introduced it. And very funny, in that time you could just get rid of the old stuff. Okay, Lisa, they sold it for a while, but it wasn't a success. Okay, just put it aside. And this computer platform basically was a standalone platform. And that's the way we still, I see a lot of organizations trying to do innovations is, okay, we have a great team. We put them on an island, we figure out the new stuff, and you should, you should start like that, but then they often also roll it out as a kind of an isolated thing, and I think that's no longer possible, because now we're in the digital era, and we all got networked. Organizations, companies, they organize themselves into value change, and they have they have to interface data. They have to know things about each other in real time. We have a lot of legislation that you have to keep your eyes on, that you have to incorporate. We all got mobile and we get devices. We're always on, 24/7, everywhere. So customer expectations grew. Other companies are doing a lot of stuff, and basically, I think that entering the playing field has gotten harder. And if you're still trying to, innovate in isolation, there's a lot of stuff you can't reuse that's still in that company. So I think nowadays, if you like it or not, you basically have to look at the stuff that's already there. So how do we get our enterprise design built? I started talking to Milan, and I said, well, I'm not sure about the right answer to that question, but I have some ideas, and I think that you have to basically where people talk to each other and know about each other's goals and each other's problems, there you get understanding and then you can move on. So part of this presentation is maybe also to create some understanding of internals of IT and the IT departments in large enterprises. And for me, the world, I think that as an enterprise designer, you can create a lot of stuff that's maybe not digital, but I think today everything you do has digital components. There's an app in it, there's a portal in it, maybe an information appliance at an airport, you never know. So, and enterprises, large enterprises, already have a lot of this stuff. There's a lot of digital artifacts, a lot of systems already in place. And if you have an enterprise design, you're probably going to put new stuff in. And I think you need to reuse at least part of the old stuff. And this is an example. For instance, if you look at the airline industry, then they basically started out, and I think it was in the 60s of the previous century, that they started out with the reservation systems. I think that Amadeus was one of the first big software systems where you could make reservations and spread them throughout the industry, that everyone knew, okay, someone's going to fly, we now know what we need to do. Reservation systems are still used by airlines, and basically they are still built like in the 60s. They upgraded some of the technologies, but these systems need to be operated by staff of the airline themselves. Well, and you know, of course, oh, wait a minute, Joost, I'm booking on a website now, I'm doing it myself. Correct. We build something on top. And this is the self-service website. And basically, we build it, so you could do that yourself. But it's an add-on. It's not part of this system, if you look in the back office. Not everything is successful online, so we also created the customer care system. You can still call a call center or email a call center, a service desk, and they are going to help you. And if you do that a lot, we are wondering, okay, what's happening? Also, we want to mail you about all kinds of stuff. So we created a customer relationship management system, again, on top of everything we have already. And nowadays, we don't need you to think about what you want because we already know it. We have insights, we have prediction. So we put in a data analytics platform on top. But basically, here in this, here in the bottom, still that old system is still there, doing its job, and that's part of enterprise inertia, because this system is kind of a problem. We need it, but it's also built on old-fashioned concepts. And if you look at those systems in another way, we have a kind of an abstractions, and we say, well, that reservation system is what we call a system of record. It logs transactions. It basically logs that you are going to fly on a certain date, on a certain flight. And around that, we created systems of coordination, because there's not one system of there's not one system of record. There are many more, and every system of records basically only knows about its own records, its own transactions. But if you look at it from an outside perspective, you say, "Hey, wait a minute! Most things we do is a flow or a sequence of transactions, and we need to coordinate that." Well, that's that's also a brand of systems that we thought about. Then there was the time that we created systems of engagement. Oh, because these systems in the early days, they coordinated staff, your own staff in your organization. But now we want to engage customers and basically let them, well, do the work. But also let them have fun at it and let them return to buy more. So these are also kind of systems, and they are all different. And now we have the systems of insight, and they all have different characteristics. If you look at the systems of records, they are from the 60s, from the 70s, even from the 80s. Some people still build them today, because basically we need them. But they are transaction oriented. They are very domain or product specific. So if you try to combine products, I don't know if any one of you. A couple of years ago, I had a private telecom subscription, and they needed to move it to a business subscription, and they just said, "Apply again." Don't. I said, "Well, just put another check mark. Put a check mark to business." And they said, "No. You have to apply again because we can't move your private subscription to a business subscription." Basically, probably because they have two different systems. Systems of records also have the peculiar thing that they always want to be right, and that they always need to be consistent. So we can't have the problem that you are maybe flying on the 3rd of November. No, you are going to fly. And if you are going to change that, we need that change, and it needs to be in the system, because then you are not going to fly on the 3rd of November anymore. So basically, and development is often hard for the system, based sometimes on technology, but also sometimes on business rules. To be right and to be consistent, there are a lot of rules in place. So this is really a system that that is hard to change once you have put it in place. Well, systems of coordination. Business process management systems or workflow management systems, they are easier because they are created to coordinate systems of records. And here we have the added things that the process must be right. Not everything in the system must be right, but we are managing the process, so the process and the status, we need to be right about that. There's a lot of configuration. Doing it right is still a bit hard. And also integration in these systems is often hard. And conceptually, but also because technology in these kind of systems, there was a lot of vendor-specific technology involved. If you look at the systems of engagement, I think they came up around 2000, can be a bit earlier. Basically, when the internet and commercial websites started to be built, these kind of systems also were introduced. And what you see here is they are people-oriented. They are looking towards the user. There's a user that wants to do something, and you get all. You basically are talking about usability and getting things done by someone who maybe didn't experience the system before. It's completely different as with the system of records. With system of records, we can send our staff to training. We can train them 2 weeks to use the system, to be able to basically tame the system. And but here it got different. And also there's people orientation. And if you are a customer of an organization, you probably you use multiple services. You maybe have bought multiple products. So this is very people oriented, but it's not product oriented or service oriented. And because that's what these systems are. So there's a mismatch. This system is trying to connect the dots, probably using this system. But many transactions still have to be recorded here. We have a lot of new technology. I love that, because now configuration is basically easy. Integration is easier. And the fun part is, I had earlier this year, again, a discussion with a supplier, and he said, well, Joost, listen, integration is really easy. This system can connect to anything. He says, yes, right, completely. I believe it. No, but it's true. It's really true. His system, being a very modern platform, can connect to anything. But basically, I have a system here in my landscape that connects to nothing, that still thinks that it's the master of the world. It's God. It can do anything. It still has not only the product and the transactions in it, but also all the customer data, because otherwise it won't work. But we are also needing that customer information, that product information here. But this system doesn't want to tell us about it. So this supplier is right. My system can connect to anything. But I say, yeah, great. But I still have systems of records that are hard to integrate with, because the system doesn't know that there's an outside world where it needs to be part of it. And basically, the supplier is keeping it that way because that's their way to make money. If you want to change something, you need the supplier to ask for that change. Now, lately we have systems of insights. We are building all kinds of... it began maybe with data warehouses, but now big data analysis tools, predictive analysis tools. And what you see here is development is easy. You need WizKids still, but they script anything together. Integration is easy because it's used to integrate. It's used to get all data in and do a lot of interesting analysis on it. And well, and changing it, we can change it within a day or within 2 days and try a new analysis, try a new model. And see if we get some insight out of it that we can help to, for instance, improve our engagement or improve our processes and maybe even improve our systems of records, although, no, these are great again. These are already great. They are doing their work very good, is what the supplier says. Now, if you are trying to create something new, and most of the time what we are nowadays do as enterprise designers, we are working on systems of engagement. Because this stuff is already in place. The fact that there is many times a kind of an enterprise awkwardness is basically because we have this already, we have this in place. And the enterprise thinks, well, we are done now, but we are no longer done. But as a customer, as a user, we have higher expectations. We want it to be a good flow. We want it to be easy. And most of the changes you do are probably here. We are building new systems of engagement. And if you are lucky, you only need to get data out of the old systems, some reference data, and use that, and that's a nice green arrow. this most of the time will you'll manage this, and your IT department too. But if you are in your system of engagement, are trying to get data back in, are trying to get additional transactions, then it gets uglier, and it still does, and it's not because the platforms and the tools we use here are inadequate. It's more because these systems are really difficult to change. They resist change because they are not built that way. They are not built to be easily changed. And we can't decommission them because they have the basic transactions, the basic knowledge of our enterprise still in them. So it's always trying to look, okay, how can we do this? And I think also, because I already said, in my opinion, you can't do the isolated, we'll do it just next to everything else approach. You have to think about, okay, how do we get this integration in place? Mostly I say, well, probably through the layering of using the systems in between. Well, Enterprise Rebel, find the parts and data that must be reused and build them in layers. And the more you touch the existing systems, and certainly where you are going to do updates in the existing systems, there is going to be some work, and you probably have to design it up front. Think about it. Think together with all other people. Otherwise, it will haunt you in the end. Well, and then you have the point of okay, great. We have our next innovation. We're going to build it. But in large enterprises, there is and certainly if you look at it from an IT point of view, there is not a lot of cash left for innovation. I think that in most enterprises, almost 90% of IT budget is spent on the systems, on the IT that's already there. Just keeping it running. And also keeping it from failing. So, well, you can't do a lot in that. What we did with a number of clients is that we say, well, maybe you should start using different portfolio techniques. So think differently about your IT assets and about your landscape. And this is based on the model of Geoffrey Moore. We like him a lot because he says you have to think about what you want to do next, invent, experiment. You then have to deploy it. If it's successful, if you like it, you have to deploy it at scale. But basically, after a while, it just gets business as usual. So you have to manage it in a different way. And finally, when it gets outdated, you have to extract it out of your landscape. And we translated that to a number of maybe architectural principles or statements. We say, okay, experiment, fail fast. There's no architecture involved. You can do anything you want, but keep it as small investments because there's not a lot of money. So this is pilots and proof of concepts. And if you're going to if you see something successful, then you want to be disruptive with it. So we have an architecture for differentiation, which enables, for instance, and allows custom development. And this is quite expensive because you are going to custom build some parts that differentiate you from all the others in your industry. And so it's expensive, but it's contained. We have thought about it. And if you're no longer differentiated, then basically you are becoming industry specific. Then we have a standards architecture. We basically say, you need to comply to industry standards. And if you can comply to industry standards, then you are basically, you can buy a common off-the-shelf product. You can call a supplier and you can say, I want to implement your system. I want to buy and implement your system and use it. And in this last quadrant, we also have a standards architecture, but this is really industry agnostic. This is where network, Office 365 lives, the basic components that you can get almost out of the wall, like you can get your energy out of the wall. And this should be cheap. And that's basically also what's behind this, is that because this is expensive, but you need it to be different. Here you need to select on price performance. You need this IT should be cheaper, and this IT should even be cheaper. And really, this is really thinking about putting the money where you need it the most. I have a lot of, I know a lot of clients still that put a lot of money in this kind of systems. And basically, you have to move that out there. Now, this is you can say it's 20% of systems, 80% of systems there. This is no longer the money. You can maybe put 30% here, 35% here, and less money there. And from an enterprise design, a new enterprise design, you want to be here. Maybe you can also select some standard components, but most of the time you're here trying to experiment, prototype, or really build a system. Now, if you are a true enterprise rebel, then of course you say, I have an experiment, but I'm going to build it on this platform. So it will already be, whether it fails or not, it will be part of the allowed IT. And or you say, you know, all the other other things as a rebel, you say, I can never get it this funded, but I'm in a company that's averse to losing money. So I'll let it build as an experiment. I'll put it down as an experiment, and then once it's built, no one is going to put it out. I don't like that as an enterprise architect, but as a rebel, you can use that option. So basically, as an enterprise rebel, look into your IT department and see how you can put your initiative in the portfolio and where you can use it. When you are talking to that IT department, also really look at to whom you are talking. What is his or her role in the organization? Many IT departments have a very a gap or a border between what they call operations and what they call development. And I once was in an assignment where I was hired as an enterprise architect, and I tried to make some new architecture, wanted it built, and it took me 6 months to realize that I wasn't part of the development environment, but I was part of operations. And operations is not about changing things, but it's about keeping the things the same and stable. And they really, it was a strange situation because they hired me as an enterprise architect, but they wanted to do some what they call big changes, but they weren't innovative. No, what they wanted was make it more stable. What we have now, make that more stable. So do small changes. And it isn't going to work. So talking to the right people to get your enterprise design built is really, really important. And if you look at the difference in operations and development, operations, you're always talking to operations if you're calling a service desk or a help desk. Or if you see someone being a service level manager, if they're talking about change requests, or change budget, and they are talking about service level agreement. That's basically operations, and they want the IT to work as stable, the current IT as stable as possible, so there are no complaints. If you want to be in development and you want to create something innovative, then you have to see to talk to some of these peoples. So basically, as a rebel, know who you are talking to. And and this is hard for engineers, because they think the organization is engineered. So you just have to find the right role and talk to them. But use the informal influencers. So people that like you or like your ideas, and use them also to get the IT department running. Now, something what's also nice, and it's more about what I talked before about integration. We all love models, at least I do, but models are always an abstraction of reality. And in the fashion magazines, you see that pictures are retouched to edited in Photoshop to look people nicer, but also. As architects, we have that problem. For instance, we have this very nice model, business object model. And this is talking about the things that in enterprises we like to have data on, that we like to, this is the world we are doing business in, but then basically put down in data and data structures. And I have some detail. Okay, this is really also, again, an ugly model. But basically, we say we have a customer here who can place orders. An order consists of order line. On an order line, you can order a product. This structure enables us to sell multiple different products on one order. And maybe we also want to know that the product is purchased at a certain supplier. And if you're talking about customers, then there's something really peculiar happening in most enterprises. That's because every system adds customers. Every new system adds customers. So this is your customer base. And direct marketing says, no. There's a lot of people we are emailing, but not everyone is buying. So this is our customer base. Someone else says, no. You are basically, that's our customers. But we are selling a different product, so our customer base is different. And, we are only doing it to B2B partners, selling stuff. And, you can also always find someone who has a different customer base. But basically, what you have to do is one customer data set definition. It's really ugly. Because you have to talk to a lot of people. As an architect, this is the fun part of my work. This is talking to a lot of people and trying to get them in one room and making it happen. Guys, we have to talk about one customer definition, and then we have to combine things, and then you have to say which subset of that customer base do you want to have, because we can integrate that and we can rescue your project somehow. And this is also ugly, because as an architect we say, no, there's one customer base, and ideally you have one database where all your customer data is in. But all those suppliers and different departments, they all want their own systems and they want their own customer data in their own system. So basically what we're saying, not one database, but please let's have one data set and let's coordinate that we all looking, if we are talking about customer Johnson, that we are all looking at the same data of that Johnson, are all on the same page. This is really that Johnson from that city that we're talking about. Given the time, I have some, if you're talking about customer data in different systems, you have to talk about integration patterns, but I'm going to skip that. And basically go to the takeaway, because if you're going to invest in integration, nowadays a lot of people will suggest you the data integration that's easiest to build. And then you get a data feed once every 24 hours with updates. And systems of engagement don't work like that. You want to be really responsive. If someone is using your portal or your app, you really want that data to be in sync with everything behind it. So what you basically need to look at, if someone is suggesting you to have a 24-hour data feed, you say, no. I want it real time. I want it event-based. I want my system to... I don't want to query for data when someone is on my website or in my app. The data must already be there. And that's hard from a technical point of view. But it's the only way that in the long term your system is going, the experience to the user is going to be the best there is. Well, this basically sums it up. As a rebel, sometimes you need to rebel. You need to say, we have to do things differently, or I have to talk to people who are not in the right role, maybe. Use some influences. But also there are some parts that, as a rebel, you need to be a nice rebel, that you really need to talk to the IT department and to architects about, and it's basically how do I get the right data, how do I get the right integration, so my new system works perfectly for the user or the customer that's using it. Looking forward from an architecture point of view, wasn't completely part of the presentation, but when I made it, I thought, okay, this is maybe, maybe of some interest. What we are looking at now at some of our car lines is that we are no longer building systems of engagement, but we are building APIs of engagement, application programming interfaces, basically because we now see that our customers are on platforms that we don't control, are in channels that we don't control anymore. And I'm working for an airline with a 96 recognition percentage as a brand, who put a lot of money in their own website, but they now see that, for instance, Google Flights is more and more used by people. And if you can't integrate with Google Flights, you're missing business. So we see large portals like Google and Facebook that you need to integrate with. So basically, we are moving towards making APIs. And also, when you see if you are working with that kind of parties, you really have to be able to scale. So we also see from a technology point of view, if you heard a word, that there is a new technology that we are building API platforms with microservice technology. Once now you've heard it, now you can never get it out of your system. Okay, thank you.
I think there's time for one question, if you have one. You were the quickest.
Thanks, Joost, for this excellent overview of enterprise architecture. I have one question about the slide where you had the different systems and the green and the yellow arrow. So you said that the arrow going back in the systems is messy. I was just wondering, could you give a concrete example what this, for example, means for customer experience?
Well, yeah, from a customer experience point is that sometimes the data is not updated in real time. So you have done something on the website. You bought something. You built and you then call customer the call center, and they don't know about your transaction yet. And basically, maybe in 5 minutes they do, but not in real time. And the other thing is that, for instance, I've worked with an application with a system of records that included a financial transaction, so paying for what you ordered. And there we tried to expand, to add more products to the order. But some of those products, some of those services, they needed their own payment channel, and we couldn't get everything on one invoice. And there you also see some kind of disconnect, because you are ordering three things as part of one action on the website, but you're getting two invoices. And sometimes we even say, okay, we are not going to offer this service, because basically those two invoices, they look weird. So there is impact on customer experience, and sometimes you take that impact and you try some reassuring messages in the order confirmation and in the invoices, and sometimes, well, you just don't do it. Basically, removing the system will take us, I think, another 4 years. Yeah, sometimes it is.
Thank you.